Well, I want to start off by saying I really like your website. I've been checking it out for a long time.
Save that for the plugs.
Okay.
That'll be good. I like promotion. Save that for the plugs. All right. So, make sure I clear my throat here.
So, Flickr, the flickr.com/my handle, like, it's Big Forsland, but I like my name, but it says like Nick Forsland on my thing. Which one?
You're searchable. Go by your username with the four.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
You're listening to the American Urbex Podcast. My name is Ken. We're back here in Gary. I'm sitting down with a new group of people. One person on my left or right in front of me I know and I'm familiar with. The other person to my right I just met, and I'm quite impressed by the work he does. So the person right in front of me, you ugly mug, why don't you introduce yourself for the listeners? Who are you?
I'm Nick Forsland.
And how did you get involved with Urbex?
I've always been interested in photography. Usually I was the guy with the camera.
And how long have you been doing this?
This specifically is about 2 or 3 years.
About 2 or 3 years. How are you a Canon or a Nikon guy?
Nikon.
Nikon. You say that with such disdain.
Yeah, well, depends on the crowd.
All right. I'm proud to introduce...
Nitrum 242.
And tell us a little bit about yourself. Nitrum, how long have you been doing the Urbex thing?
For about 4 years now.
For about 4 years now. Are you Canon or a Nikon guy?
Well, initially Sony, but Nikon.
Nikon. Yeah. All right. I'm sitting down with two Nikon guys.
All right. Then I'm in the majority.
I'm outnumbered. I can hold my own. All right. Nick, I'm going to start with you. How did you get first involved with Urbex?
Originally, it was a photography project in my film photography class. I picked a theme, and I went with nature destroying human structure. And I just went out on the trip and started looking at barns and things that were collapsing. And then I noticed you had this kind of general idea with your own stuff, and I just latched on. And
full disclosure for the listeners, Nick and I know each other previously. Yes. We used to work with each other. And last year, about this time, we went to, about August, it was about August, we came down here to Gary and shot things within the city, and Nick was fortunate enough to use a lot of that material in your senior project, right?
Yes.
So you had that on display, and tell us about the project. What did you assemble?
I made a photography book.
What's the title of the book?
Oh, it was Gary, a texture tour, and most of the photos I was taking were straight on of walls or floors or just piles of brick, just trying to get the gritty feel of the destruction.
Okay, and you assembled this into a book. How many copies have you sold? May I ask that personal question?
How many did you buy?
I bought one.
Okay, so two, besides the ones I bought.
Well, they're really rare, and sometime in the future, they'll be up for auction, and, you know, when you're a famous photographer.
Well, they're built to order, so you gotta order. I don't have an inventory of them.
Where can we get those?
Blurb.com.
Blurb.com.
And you look up Nick Forsland. You look up Gary, a texture tour.
How'd the university treat you on that final project, by the way?
They liked it.
They liked it?
Yeah, not many people noticed the spelling error.
Shh! Don't tell anybody about that.
Yeah, they all really liked it. The dean and the head of the art department.
It was interesting. It was interesting because I was there and I was hovering around the book because you included two of my photos,
yes.
I think. And the people who were looking at this final project, you had one of the more interesting projects to the room because people were confronted with scenes from a major American city that they never thought could exist in modern day America, and hearing some of their reactions, some of the audible gasps were you know, did they share that with you?
Yeah, there were a lot of people blown away. They had no idea. especially with the I had the large photo of the interior of the church here, of the main sanctuary. Yeah, a lot of people were just had no idea this you know, American industrial city has just collapsed in on itself.
All right, I'm going to move on to Nitrum 242 on Flickr. I came across your photos initially while researching Urbex locations in the area, and your Flickr account has some 6,500 photos, and I checked the dates on some of the first one, and they're from 2009. The volume of work that you put up there is quite impressive. What drives you to go to so many locations? Because I have to admit, I have used your shots to research locations and make a database of places I need to go and check out and see.
I appreciate that.
And I've been able, actually, because of the volume of your photos, without relying on GPS information, I've been able to triangulate where places are or how to get in. Like, that's the volume of some of the photos you take. So tell me, what drives you?
Well, initially, I did it for the passion of documenting old buildings.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm putting more time into having a creative shot. But what drove me was an old racetrack in Cicero, Illinois, because my dad used to take me there as a kid. And I remember having fond memories of this old racetrack, Sportsman's Park in Cicero. And one day, it closed, and I just kept driving by there. It's 20 minutes from my house. And I had just had a little camera on me, a little point and shoot. Took a few shots. Then I'm like, why don't I get my real camera and really take beautiful shots and document? Because it was slowly degrading over time. Then I see an open window, go in. And from there, my passion for documenting history and old buildings came about.
Let's go back. What do you do for a living right now?
I'm an engineer. I work at a steel factory.
So you work very closely with American industry and
exactly.
Yeah.
And my dad is an engineer, and it's saddened that this economy is so bad that manufacturing jobs are disappearing.
Is there a correlation with what you see at some of these industrial locations and what you do day to day? Like, does it tell a story?
Yeah, well, when I see an old boiler, I know how that boiler works, and it's a big, awesome piece of machine, and I see it there like rot. I walk into a building, and I know how long a building's been abandoned. Just even a year, it takes 1 year for one hot summer and one cold winter for a building to just be like devastated.
Tell me a little bit about the state of American industry. Where are we going? What's going on? What's making these Urbex locations possible or making them a reality?
Well,
and you can be blunt. You can be very blunt.
I believe that in the 70s, there should have been more initiatives to save our economy instead of importing from China or India or Mexico. What probably happened is cheap labor, and companies got greedy. Go to Cleveland, go to Pittsburgh is okay now, but Detroit,
mm-hmm.
a lot of problems with the greed. You know, instead of paying somebody here a lot of money, you just go ship the job out to India.
You know, one of the thing that I always think about when I go to an industrial location is that those places tell the story of the middle class achieving the American dream.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Gary's a good example of that.
Yeah.
I remember Gary a couple years ago, and it just seems like every year it just gets worse and worse ever since the steel industry, you know, went down.
So would you say that some of the photos that you do, you go to so many locations, you take the photos, you post them online, is there... I don't want to say an informative component to it. You want to get people, you know, you want to show them these things. Like,
I like the excitement of it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get me wrong. I mean, going into a building is really exciting. An abandoned building is really exciting.
Uh-huh.
But really I go because I want to document
mm-hmm.
the building. Like, one time a building brought a lot of joy to people, you know, a lot of hope to people. And now to see if they're abandoned, is, you know, sad.
Would you call yourself an activist for preservation? And
I probably would say that there should be more effort into saving buildings from becoming abandoned.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I could understand preserving a building, but if it's already in like bad shape, tear it down.
You know, it's always a quandary with urban explorers that, you know, we love decay. We love abandonment. We love these sorts of locations. But it's also sad, in a way, to see that we got to this point. To this point. I want you to tell me about, since you have a wide library of locations, tell me about one particular location that's your favorite.
Well, the Purple Hotel in Lincolnwood,
mm-hmm.
only because I like the architectural style.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to give much information on like places I've been inside. I don't really, you know, I don't really talk about it. But like one of my favorite spots is like Chicagoland area.
Mm-hmm.
All the Chicago spots I've been to.
Mm-hmm. Now, what is it about the Purple Hotel that you found so interesting?
Just the look of the building.
The look of the building. For the
design of the building.
Yeah, I just recently did an article on that, the Purple Hotel. It's going to be torn down come August.
Yeah,
Lincolnwood has won a couple of legal cases against the owner. I think it's for sale for some $26, $27, $28 million, and it's an eyesore. I think there's no other way to put it from the city's perspective.
Sadly, it probably should be torn down. Maybe what I'm hoping is save the bricks and make a fountain in that spot.
I heard they were going to make a park. That's a great idea. Yeah. That's a great idea. Those purple the building, for those of you who've never seen the Purple Hotel, is aptly named because the Hilton Company, I want to say, in the 1960s when they were building the hotel, were supposed to have blue bricks. They didn't get blue bricks. They got purple bricks. So they built a purple hotel. Michael Jordan stayed there. His first night in Chicago. When,
Barry Manilow used to go there a lot.
Roberta
Flack.
It's a wonderful history. Wonderful history on this place. Check out that article on American Urbex, listeners. Check it out. I'll link to it in the podcast notes. Nick,
mm-hmm.
tell me about one of your favorite locations.
Maybe here. At least it was in someplace in Gary. Here or...
you mean City Methodist in
City
general?
Methodist, yeah, City Methodist, just because... the amount that it's gone, from what it was to what it is now.
Now, we are here as part of the Urbex Explorer Chicago group meetup today, which met at noon. We got here at 11, so we had some time to kill beforehand. And, you know, you were remarking to me about the condition of the building. We were here in August of last year, and it is now June.
Yes.
Tell me what you've seen.
In the main sanctuary, a good section of the sub-roof has collapsed, a decorative section, the roof of a stairwell has come in, the walls are just gone.
What do we notice at the front of the church? In the floor? There was a pastor who, in the 1950s and 1960s, he had passed away. I have to double check this fact, but you were telling me that he was buried.
Yeah, I saw an article a while ago. He was... that his remains were put under a tile in the floor in the main area, and we see one that's been removed, and there's a cavity, and there's nothing there.
It appears that something has been ripped out of there. Hopefully, it's been relocated appropriately. You touch on something very interesting about locations, is that you visit them one time, and then you visit them sometime later, and they've changed greatly. There's something about the forces of nature and time that wear these places down. Have you ever been to a location that has changed significantly, Nitram?
Well, like the Purple Hotel. I remember going in, and you know, some of the windows would be open,
mm-hmm.
and those same rooms going back a year later have more mold and more just dampness to it. But yeah, a lot of places, I'll go one year, now when I return, it's bad. It's worse. So
it's definitely worth going, documenting it, something magnificent when you see it, because it might not be there again, right?
Do it to document it. But yeah, I agree.
Yeah. I have many, many times I've some of the earlier Urbex locations I've gone to, I've seen things, tried to take a photo of it, wasn't patient enough, and then I missed it forever because I come back and it's completely gone. Let's talk about the Urbex community at all. Is this your first meetup, Nitrum?
It is, yeah.
It is? Yeah. So you've never been to an Explorer Chicago thing?
No, I've never actually. I've run into a few people here and there, but I mainly explore just me and my buddy, and that's about it.
Well, me too. I've never formally met up with a group. This is my first time. Nick, you've been on the prowl with me a couple of times.
Yeah, I've never been on a public meetup type this, or a group meetup, just with some chums.
And one of the nice things about groups is that you can get together, you can meet with people, you can touch base, and we're going to be going and visiting some undisclosed locations immediately after this. I want to talk about, Nitrum, some of your methods. Nick, I know we hang out quite a bit, and I do a lot of the research because I run the website. I want to talk about some of your methods, you know, because you do so much. You're out almost every weekend. Like,
well,
what do you do? Like, explain it to me as though I'm a beginner, okay? What is it you're looking for? What is it you do?
Photography is my passion.
Okay.
And my dad's a photographer, mm-hmm. and I just enjoy it. And what really gets me excited are just exploring abandoned buildings. Mm-hmm. But I go, because I want to like preserve the history, I want to document time. Because once a building's gone, it's gone.
But how do you find these locations? I mean, do you search the internet or?
I do a little internet.
Okay.
But I actually feel like I have like a radar for abandoned buildings. I remember one time in St. Louis, I just went up a street and there's an abandoned school.
Mm-hmm.
And one day I went to Cleveland for a mm-hmm. couple days and I took a little side route, ended up in an abandoned hotel in Toledo.
How many miles do you put on your car in a year?
A lot.
You put on
a lot. Well, 2010, I was unemployed.
Okay.
So that's why I was able to do a lot of traveling. I was unemployed for almost a year. So I went to Detroit. I would go to Detroit, come home, chill, go to Cleveland the next weekend, chill, go up to Toronto.
You know,
I had that luxury because I had a really good job before, so I had money put away.
I completely understand. I'm underemployed. I've been underemployed since graduating from college. Yeah. And one of the things that is kind of nice about it is that you do have the time to go out, take an extended weekend, take a day off from work, go explore it. But
a lot of why I do this, too, because right now I know places that are gone that mm-hmm. I've been to. Mm-hmm. Like right now in Cleveland, they're tearing down the old Cleveland cold storage factory.
Okay.
Awesome building. In Detroit, there's four schools that I went into that are gone. So I feel like the urge to do it now because abandoned buildings are not going to last forever. You know, they're going to be torn down eventually.
They're going to be gone.
Yeah.
They're going to be gone. And if local governments and federal government doesn't make an effort to tear down that building, time and nature will.
It will, yeah.
So it's completely gone.
Like, places will have a second floor, and over time, the floor will collapse. There is a building here in Gary
mm-hmm.
that's demolished now, but you could not go up to the second floor because it just...
That's true. We discovered today that some of the stairwells in the church here are completely gone. You can't... It's not safe.
And they were here last year.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. Let's talk a little bit, Nick and Nitrum. From your experience... there are so many new people getting involved with this hobby and activity now that photo sharing sites are more popular. DSLRs are getting, the prices are coming down on them. They're becoming more accessible. People are buying MacBooks with iPhoto and iMovie and they want to make beautiful products. I think this this activity is more accessible. What would you tell new people who are getting involved with this? Like, share some tips. Nick, I want you to go first.
Just shoot a lot. Just get out there. Don't be lazy.
Don't be lazy.
That's good advice, yeah.
Yeah. Or do your research. I mean, look up what you want. I mean, you gotta...
Why is it important to shoot a lot when you go out to a new location?
You learn, you learn the equipment. You gotta see where your mistakes are.
I had this problem last time when we went to Gary because we shot Horace Mann. I got home, 25% of my photos corrupted, but because I had taken so many photos, I had enough in reserve to work with, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What are some other things? What piece of equipment are you missing today?
I don't have a car charger. I don't have a
little flashlight.
Oh, flashlight. Yeah,
flashlight is so important. Yeah. People,
I carry those on me all the time.
Yeah, like, yeah. The Maglite. I
still have not picked one up.
This is an unofficial endorsement for Maglite flashlights. I love their product a lot. Yeah, it is darker than you think in a lot of these locations, and most people beginning don't always bring a flashlight, and it can help you tremendously. It can help you from a nice 10, 15, 20, 30 foot fall. So tips from you, Nitram.
Well, like you just said, be careful. When you hit up abandoned buildings, bring a flashlight and just be careful. But I mean, it's exciting to take a picture, to take pictures of abandoned buildings. That's why I do it so much. If you know the history of the building,
mm-hmm.
and do it for a good reason.
And how can people know the history of the building?
Well, I want to know.
Uh-huh.
And because like for example, schools,
mm-hmm.
I want to know why it closed. I want to know who went.
Mm-hmm.
And especially when you see like pictures of like yearbooks of like all the students, like at one time that school meant a lot to somebody. So I want to know the history. Why, you know, about it.
Mm-hmm. One other thing, is it important to bring people with you, and why?
I would say, if you can, yes. I have been in places by myself, but I don't like it.
Yeah, one of the things that, why it's important at the beginning, when you're just getting started, you need a buddy. You never know what's going to happen. If you know, do your research beforehand, and you get a little more experience. Some of the locations, I'll admit, I've gone to by myself. It's just easier to do some of the photography work. But yeah, hook up with somebody, bring the proper gear, be safe, explore, have fun. And you know, just experiment, take a lot of photos. Let's talk a little bit with, once you get those photos, you start showing people, what are their reactions? What, for you, Nick, what have people's reactions been to your photos? What have your family think?
Well, they like them, but they're not going to, you know, they wouldn't say otherwise.
Oh, okay.
But, they're supportive.
What do you do? What does your family think?
Well, my dad thinks it's cool. See, my dad used to kind of go exploring when he was younger.
Mm-hmm.
He's a photographer.
Mm-hmm.
And but my mom, she doesn't really know much about it. I don't really show my mom my pictures, but my aunt, she loves them.
Yeah.
And I printed out a few, and I'll show my uncles and my cousins, and they think it's cool.
It's really unexpected. It's been my experience with these photos. You find an audience in some of the weirdest places, people you'd never expect. So, and that's partially why I keep doing it. I kind of like the shock value of it.
I do too.
Yeah. It's wonderful. It's wonderful. I want to thank you guys both for sitting down with me today and recording this podcast. Where can people find your stuff, Nick?
I have a Flickr. If you look it up, it's under Big Forslund, B-I-G, the number 4, S-L-U-N-D.
Mm-hmm. Nitram, where can we find your stuff?
Right now, only on Flickr, N-I-T-R-A-M 242.
All right, and I would ask that you guys please submit your wonderful photos to the American Urbex group on Flickr. The link for that will be on the podcast notes for this episode. Thanks, guys, for sitting down. And to you guys listening out there, stay tuned to the American Urbex podcast. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next week.